Hi everyone, Oskar Świerat here. Welcome to the first part of the tutorial about graphics profiling in Unreal Engine 4. In this video I will show you various ways to measure performance expressed in milliseconds before we proceed with looking for bottlenecks and other optimization issues. So why milliseconds? This is the most important question for this tutorial. Why we should use milliseconds? Basically it comes to this. You have to measure and compare your results, for example, when checking if your changes affected the scene in a positive or negative way, and it's very hard to compare certain specific features in the FPS. The frames per second are very useful for benchmarks. They are very common, as you know, testing if a game runs in 30 or 60 FPS on a certain hardware, so why is this quite useless for us? Well, it comes to how hard it is to express a cost of a certain feature in FPS. Let's look at it that way. We have a light that, when we put it on the scene, we dropped from 60 to 50 FPS, for example, a very heavy shadowed light. So if you assume that the cost of the certain light was 10 FPS, then by placing 5 another lights of this kind, will leave us with 0 FPS? No, it certainly doesn't work that way. Another example can be found here. This is a scene optimized for 30 FPS. If we want to have 30 frames per second, and we have 1000 milliseconds in a second, then by doing the simple calculation, 1000 divided by our desired FPS, which is 30, we can see it leaves us with 33 milliseconds to render a frame. If we exceed this number when doing calculations on the GPU or the CPU, we won't hit the target of 30 frames per second. In the same manner, 1000 divided by 60 frames per second leaves us with the 16 milliseconds to render a frame. Now here, trying to achieve 30 FPS, we have a scene that renders at 30 milliseconds. It has a lot of transparency, a lot of heavy lighting, and in the right part of the image, you can see that the post-process is using 3 milliseconds. It's also shown here in the GPU visualizer. This bar is the time it takes to render entire scene, the cost of rendering a single frame. Now please look at this graph. This is a scene that has to render in 60 FPS, and the post-process time didn't change. We still have a cost of 3 milliseconds here and here. But the cost of 3 milliseconds is a significantly bigger chunk of the time we have to render a scene at twice the frame rate. We have to fit in 15 milliseconds total. So you can easily assume that by disabling the post-process entirely, we will have 12 milliseconds per frame, sorry, which is not enough to land at the target of 11 milliseconds, that is 90 FPS for example, VR kit like Oculus or Vive. So as you can see, even if the cost of the post-process is static, now when rendering for a VR kit, it's much more significant compared to the other things. So we had to disable translucency at all, get rid of all particles and stuff, which left us with place to do this post-process and to have still a medium number of lights. Using milliseconds instead of raw FPS can allow us to break down the entire scene into separate passes and compare their costs, not just look at the final result, the final number of FPS. The basic console commands are entered by pressing tilde in your game. The key tilde is located on the left from the number 1 on keyboard. And then you enter the command, for example, stat FPS, stat unitgraph. And the case of the letters doesn't matter. Then you press enter. Stat FPS shows us both the final number of frames per second we achieved and the time it takes to render a frame, the total time. But we don't know yet if the cost is caused by a CPU or the GPU, because one will have to wait for another. The GPU will have to wait for the CPU if the CPU needs more time to finish the frame, the gameplay code, drawing code and stuff. So by using statUnit or statUnitGraph, we can divide this information into four specific parts. Frame is the same as with FPS, the final cost. Game is the gameplay code, the work of the CPU on the gameplay code. Draw is the work on the CPU to prepare data for the GPU. And for example, things like occlusion culling, which is hiding invisible objects for optimization. And the GPU is the raw time it took to render a frame on the GPU. Now to measure all this accurately, we have to enter project settings, general settings, frame rate, and disable smooth frame rate. Smooth frame rate tries to avoid spikes in frame rate and round the number to some more specific number like 30 or 60 FPS. By disabling it, we can end up with much more accurate measurements. There's also a command called StatSceneRendering that shows you draw costs. The triangle count in the entire scene is the only command that provides you with this information. The amount of dynamic lights in the scene, and, which is very interesting, the cost of translucency in your scene. Now let me show you all this in Unreal Engine. Let me open a scene which I prepared specifically for this project. I hope you like it. It looks like that. It has all the good stuff, from a very dense grass to asteroids to a high building and lights and even more lights and very heavy lit particles throughout the entire scene. When I run the scene, you can see that it runs at 44 FPS. It takes 22 milliseconds or a bit more to render the scene each frame. Now, if I press tilde and say R screen percentage, for example 50, then the scene becomes more blurry because it renders at half the resolution. So actually 1/4 of the amount of pixels, and it immediately jumps to 100 FPS, 9 milliseconds per frame. Now entering stat scene rendering provides me with this information, which may look a bit overwhelming at first, but this is the mode I thought about, that on the bottom part tells us about the draw calls that needed to be issued by the CPU to control the GPU, the amount of lights in the scene, dynamic lights, and the total cost of translucency in this particular frame. On the upper area we have much more detailed information, but I think it will become more obvious in the part 3, where I will explain the rendering pipeline specific to Unreal Engine. There is also a very interesting command introduced recently. StatGPU provides us with this information, which is much more convenient to read, and it basically splits the frame into specific passes. For example, base pass. This is the gathering of information like roughness, base color and stuff into buffers. Then we have translucency. Then post-processing is of course all the screen space stuff that's happening, like bloom, like motion blur, but also screen space reflections and ambient occlusion. Now we have dynamic lights and shadow projection, which is the shadow component of lighting. But there was one specific problem I had with StatGPU. Basically, on my GPU, that is GTX 760 from NVIDIA, enabling StatGPU didn't show anything at first time. So I just got the information about Stat Group GPU, this white text, and nothing. Nothing showed up. So what I found by reading the logs is that I had to enter program files, Epic Games, your version, engine, config. There is the file called console variables. Let's open this file, go to the end of it, and add these two lines if you have problems with StatGPU. That is r.nvidia timestamp workaround set to 0 and r.gpu stats enabled set to 1. And I think there is a reason why Epic Games disabled it on my card. Probably some stability issues. So if you want to do it, please remember that you are taking your own risk. I haven't tested the solution long enough. And you can also achieve the same kind of information by pressing Ctrl, Shift, comma, then the GPU visualizer pops up, and you also have your scene split into passes. I will explain this tool in part 3 of the tutorial, and you don't need to enable GPU statistics in any engine settings. It works every time. Now we can record all this. I will disable StatSceneRendering and go to StatGPU again. And I can tell StatStartFile. As you can see, a message popped up about StatsFile duration in the upper left corner. It started recording data. Okay, it will be enough. And then StatStopFile. Now I exit the game, I go to Window, Developer Tools, Session Frontend, and I can load a file from your project, saved, profiling, and the latest file. Now, this is profiling of CPU and GPU at the same time. We are interested in graphics profiling now, not gameplay. So I will hide this part and this. And from here, I enter the GPU. And by double clicking, I enable the passes that I'm interested in. And here on the graph, you can see how the game performs in various moments. The horizontal lines show you targets for 60fps, 30fps, 20fps. We are above the target of 60, unfortunately heading for the 30. And these are your basic tools to just enter the game, play it for a while and check how it performs in terms of raw FPS and milliseconds values. Thank you for watching this part of the tutorial. I hope you learned some useful stuff that will be the first step in profiling your scenes. Please try all this in your projects. If you get stuck, ask in the comments. I will try to help you, but also please help each other. In the description, I added links to the articles that were the source for my work here, but also to the articles that can expand your knowledge on the topic further. And now please let me invite you to the part 2 of the tutorial, in which I will explain the typical graphics pipeline of a modern GPU. With this kind of knowledge, you will be able to analyze what can happen in your scene before you do actual heavy profiling in the later stage, covered in part 3 and part 4. Thank you again for watching and see ya!